Well, my name is Ted Clement. I'm the Artistic Director of Crown Productions Theater Company. I would like to thank you very much for joining us for this, our final production of our 2014-2015 season here at wonderful AS220. I wanted to say very briefly that we're so happy to be here at AS220. We love producing theater here. If you're looking for the place where art is happening in Rhode Island and Providence, AS220 is the place. We want to send a lot of love and appreciation for our peers here at AS220. Some housekeeping, if you haven't already done so, please take out your telephonic device. Do me a favor. Don't silence it. Be brave. Be bold. Turn it up. Boom. What the heck? I promise you, at intermission or after the show, whoever it is at the other end of that machine, they will be there. And I encourage you to tell them how good the show was and encourage them to come see the show tomorrow afternoon. Tomorrow is our last performance. We like to say word of mouth is our best kind of publicity. So, if you like what you see tonight, please tell your friends, your family to come on down at 2 o'clock tomorrow for our final performance. If you look behind you, you'll see there are a couple of red signs here. That's where the exits are in case of an emergency. If you look over here, can't really see it, but there's bathrooms over there in case you need to use the restroom. We will have one intermission. It's 10 minutes long, so of course get up, stretch your legs, don't go too far. Come back and see our second half. A heads up, there are actors entering the room from all directions. There is no place where you won't have an actor passing, so please keep that in mind. Watch out, don't trip any actors. I think that's about it. You might notice from inserts inside the program, also some postings on the wall around here, also I think in the back room as well. An announcement for our season next year. We'll be doing a series of stage readings of new plays in the fall, seeking a new play to produce. And then in the spring, we will be producing Frost Nixon, which is a wonderful play directed by the amazing Martha Duchamp. And then our final play of the year will be the Hacker Slasher Extravaganza, Kill the Virgin, by the amazing Kevin Rock. So it should be a good season next year. We hope to see you again. One more time, thank you very much for coming. We hope that you enjoy the show. Please enjoy William Shakespeare's. Wait, oh, thank you, Bethel. I almost forgot. Thank God for my stage manager. She was doing this. One thing that we're doing tonight, briefly after the show, if you're still sticking around, thank you. Briefly after the show, we'll be doing a talk. Certain members of the cast will be coming up, the director will be coming up. We'll set up some chairs, we'll sit down, we'll have a little conversation about the play, what you have thought. So I encourage you, please stick around, you are most welcome to do so. Thank you very much for reminding me. Thank you. One more time, thanks very much, and please enjoy William Shakespeare's Richard III.
Content, made glorious summer by the sun of yore. In all the clouds that lowered upon our house, in the deep bosom of the ocean buried, now are our brows bound by victorious wreaths, our bruised arms hung up from monuments, our stern alarums changed to merry meetings, our dreadful marches to delightful measures. Grim visaged war hath smoothed his wrinkled front, and now, instead of mounting barred steeds to fright the souls of fearful adversaries, he capers softly in a lady's chamber to the lascivious pleasing of a lute. I'm not shaped for sportive tricks. You're made to court an amorous looking glass. I that am rudely stacked, and want love's majesty to strut before a wanton, ambling nymph. I, that am curtailed of this fair proportion, cheated of feature by dissembling nature, deformed, unfinished, sent before my time into this waking world, scarce half made up, and that so lamely and unfashionable that dogs bark at me as I halt by them. Why, I, in this weak, piping time of peace, have no delight to pass away the time, unless to spy my shadow in the sun, kept in mine own deformity. Why, love forswore me in my mother's womb, and did corrupt frail nature with some bribe, to shrink mine arm up like a withered shrub, to place an envious mountain on my back, where sits deformity to mock my body, to shape my legs of an unequal size, to disproportion me in every part, and am I then a man to be beloved? Entertain these fair, well-spoken names. I am determined to prove a villain, and hate the idle pleasures of these days. For since this earth affords no joy to me, but to command, to check, to overbear such as are of better person than myself, I'll make my heaven to dream upon the crown, and whilst I live to account this world but hell, until this misshapen trunk that bears this head be round and paled with a glorious crown. Why, I can smile and murder whilst I smile, and cry content to that which grieves my heart, and wet my cheeks with artificial tears, and frame my face to all occasions. I'll drown more sailors than a mermaid shall. I'll slay more gazers than the basilisk. I'll play the orator as well as Nestor, deceive more slyly than Ulysses could, and send the murderous Machiavel to school. Can I do this? Cannot get a crown? A tush, were it farther off, I'll pluck it down. Plots have I laid, inductions dangerous, by drunken prophecies, libels, and dreams, to set my brother George, the Duke of Clarence, and the King, in deadly hate, the one against the other. And if King Edward be as true and just as I, and subtle, false, and treacherous, this day shall Clarence closely be mewed up about a prophecy which says that G of Edward's heirs the murderer shall be. Die, fox, down to my soul. Here Clarence comes. Brother, good day! What means this armed guard that waits upon your grace?
His Majesty, tendering my person's safety, hath appointed this conduct to convey me to the tower.
Upon what cause?
Because my name is George.
Oh, alack, my lord! That fault is none of yours. Will he shirk for that commit your godfathers? Belike His Majesty hath some intent that you shall be a new christened in the tower. What's the matter, Clarence, may I know?
Yea, Richard, when I know. For I protest as yet I do not. As I can learn, he hearkens after prophecies and dreams, and says a wizard told him that by G his issue disinherited you. before my name of George begins with G, it follows in his thought that I am.
Well, that it is when men are ruled by women. 'Tis not the king that sends you to the tower, Clarence. Look to the queen. 'Tis she that tempers him in his extremity. Who was it not she and that good man of worship, the Earl of Rivers, her brother there, that did send Lord Hastings to the tower, from whence this present day he is delivered? We are not safe, Clarence, we are not safe.
By heaven, I think there is no man as secure with the queen's
kingdom. I beseech your graces both to pardon me. His Majesty has straitly given in charge that no man shall have private conference of what degree soever with his brother.
Even so, when it please your worship, Catesby, you may partake of anything we say. We speak no treason, man. We say the king is wise and just, and that his queen, well struck in years, fair and not jealous, and that the queen's kindred are made gentle folks.
I beseech your grace to pardon me, and withal forbear your conference with the noble duke.
We know thy charge, Catesby, and will obey.
We are the queen's abjects, and must obey. Brother, farewell. I will unto the king. Meantime, this deep disgrace and wrong touches me deeper than you can imagine.
Now I know it pleases neither of us well.
Well, your imprisonment shall not be long. Meantime, have patience.
I must perforce. Farewell.
Simple, plain plans. Oh, I do love thee so. I will shortly send my soul to heaven. If heaven will take the present out of hands. But who comes here? The new delivered Hastings.
Good time of day into my gracious lord.
As much into my good lord chamberlain. Well are you welcome to the open air. How hath my lordship worked imprisonment?
With patience, my good lord, as all prisoners must, but I shall live to give thanks to them that are the cause of my imprisonment.
So shall Clarence too, for they that were your enemies are his, and have prevailed as much on him as you.
Pity that the eagle shall be mute while buzzards and kites pray at liberty.
What news abroad?
Oh, no news so sad abroad as here at home. The king is sick, weak, melancholy, his physicians fear him mightily.
Oh, now, by St. Paul, this news is bad indeed. Well, yet Captain Evil died over long, even over much consumed his royal person. It's very grievous to be thought upon. What is in, is there?
He is.
Well, go you before, I will follow. He cannot live, I hope. And yet must not die, for George be back with post-horse up to heaven. How in, urge his hatred more to Clarence with lies well steeled with weighty arguments. And if I fall not in my deep attempt, Clarence hath not another day to live. Which done? God take King Edward to his mercy. Leave the world for me to bustle.
Revenge is death. O earth, which this blood drink is, revenge is death. Either heaven with lightning
charity, which renders good for bad and blessings for curses.
Thou knowest no law of God nor man, no beast so fierce but knows some touch of pity.
But I know none, and therefore am no beast.
That's wonderful when thou dost tell the truth.
More wonderful when angels are so angry. Vouchsafe divine perfection of a woman to give me leave but to acquit myself.
Vouchsafe diffuse infection of a man but to give me leave to accuse thy cursed self.
I did not kill your husband.
Why, then he is alive.
Nay, he is dead and slain by Edward.
Thou not kill this king.
I grant thee.
Thus grant me, Hutton, then God grant me too. Thou mayest be damned for that wicked deed. Be this gentle, mild, and virtuous.
A fitter for the king of heaven than hath him.
He is in heaven where thou shalt never come.
Well, then let him thank me that helped to send him thither. For he was fitter for that place than earth.
Thou unfit for any place but hell.
Yes, one place else. You will hear me name it.
Some dungeon.
Your bed chamber.
Respite the chamber where thou liest!
Well, so will it, madam, till I lie with you.
I hope so.
I know so. But, gentle Lady Anne, is not the causer of these timeless deaths as blameful as the executioner?
Thou art the cause in most accursed effect.
Your beauty was the cause of that effect. Your beauty, which did haunt me in my sleep, to undertake the death of all the world so that I might live. 1 hour in your sleep was it.
I thought that, I tell thee, homicide, these nails should rend that beauty from my cheek.
Well, these eyes could never endure sweet beauty's wreck. Since all the world is cheered by the sun, so I, by that, it is my day, my life.
Black night, overshade thy day, and death thy life.
Curse not thyself, fair creature, thou art both.
Would I were to be revenged on thee.
It is a quarrel most unnatural to be revenged on him that loveth thee.
It is a quarrel just and reasonable to be revenged on him that slew my husband.
He that bereft thee, lady, of thy husband, did it to get thee to a better husband.
Where is he?
Here. Why dost thou stare?
Would it were mortal poison for thy sake.
Never came poison from so sweet a place.
Never hung poison on a fowler toad. Out of my sight, thou dost infect mine eyes.
Thine eyes, sweet lady, have infected mine. These eyes of thine from mine have drawn salt tears. These eyes that never shed remorseful tear. Not when thy warlike father, like a child, told the sad story of my father's death, and 20 times made pause to sob and weep. My manly eyes did scorn in humble tear. And what these sorrows could not thence exhale, that beauty had, made them blind with weeping. Thy revengeful heart cannot forgive. And lo, I lend thee this sharp-pointed sword, which if thou please to hide in this true bosom, and lay naked to the deadly struggle, and humbly beg the death upon my knee. Nay, do not pause, for I did kill King Henry. But it was thy beauty that provoked me. Nay, dispatch, it was I that slew your husband. It was thy heavenly face that set me on. Take up the sword again, and take up me.
Though I wish thy death, I will not be the executioner.
Bid me kill myself, and I will do it.
I have already.
Tush, I was in thy rage. Speak it again. And even with the word, this hand which for thy love did kill thy love, shall for thy love kill a far truer love. For both their deaths, thou shalt be accessory.
How would I knew thy heart?
Which is written on my tongue.
I fear me both are false.
Then never. Man was true.
Well, put up your sword.
What? Should I live in hope?
All men I hope live so.
Vouchsafe to wear this ring.
To take is not to give.
Well, see how this ring encompasseth thy finger. Even so thy breast encloseth my poor heart. Wear them both, for both of them and I. And if thy devoted suppliant may but beg one favor at thy gracious hand, thou dost confirm his happiness forever.
What is it?
Let it please thee, leave these sad designs to him that has more cause to be a mourner. And after I have solemnly interred at Chertsey Monastery this noble king, and wet his grave with my repentant tears, I will, with all expedient duty, see you. For brevity, this morning.
With all my heart. And much it joys me, too, to see you become so penitent.
Will give me farewell.
It is more than you deserve. But since you teach me how to flatter you, imagine I have said farewell already.
Sirs, take up the course.
Lord Chertsey, noble lord?
No, the White Friars. There attend my courting.
Was ever woman in this humor rude?
Was ever woman in this humor won? Oh, I'll have her. I will not keep her long. What, I? To take her in her heart's extremest hate, with curses in her mouth, tears in her eyes, the bleeding witness of her hatred by, having God, her conscience, and these bars against me, and I, nothing to back my suit at all, but the plain devil and dissembling looks. And yet to win her, all the world to nothing. Hath she forgot already that noble prince, Edward, her lord, whom I, some 3 months since, stabbed in my angry mood at Tewkesbury? And will she yet debase her eyes on me, that halt, and am unshapen thus? I do mistake my person all this while. By my life she finds, although I cannot, myself to be a marvelous proper man. I'll be at charges for a looking glass, and entertain some score or two of tailors to study fashions to adorn my body. Since I'm crept in favor with myself, I will maintain it with some little cost. First I'll turn yon fellow in his grave, and then return lamenting to my love. Oh, shine out, fair sun, till I have bought a glass that I may see my shadow as I pass.
Have patience, mother. There's no doubt his majesty will soon recover his accustomed health. And that you look in it, it makes him worse. Careful, mother, to take the comfort. Cheer his grace with speaking merely words.
If he were dead, what would be tied at me?
No other harm the loss of such rewards. The heavens have blessed you with a goodly son to be comforted.
Oh, he is young, and his minority is put under the trust of Richard Gloucester, a man that loves not me nor none of you.
Is it concluded that he shall be protected?
It is determined, not concluded yet, but so it must be if the king is here.
From the lords of Buckingham and Stanley.
Good time to be unto your royal grace.
God make your majesty joyful to have been.
Saw you the king today, my lord Stanley.
But now the Duke of Buckingham and I have come from visiting his majesty.
What likelihood of his amendment, lords?
Man of good hope, his grace speaks cheerfully.
God grant him health. Did you confer with him?
Madam, we did. He desires to make atonement betwixt the Duke of Gloucester and your brothers, and betwixt them and my Lord Hastings.
And do me wrong, I will not endure it. Well, who are they that complain unto the king that I, forsooth, am stirred and love them not? By holy Paul, they love his grace but lightly, that fill his ears with such dissentious rumors. Oh, because I cannot flatter and speak fair, smile in men's faces, smooth, deceive, and calm. Well, I must be held a rancorous enemy.
To whom in all this presence speaks you grace?
To thee, that hath nor honesty nor grace. A plague upon you all. His royal person cannot be quiet, scarce a breathing while, yet you must fill his ears with lewd complaints.
Brother of Gloucester, you mistake the matter. The king of his own royal disposition, aiming belike at your interior hatred against my kindred and myself, makes him dissent that he may gather the ground of your ill will.
Well, I cannot tell. The world has grown so bad that wrens may prey where eagles dare not perch. Since every jack became a gentleman, there is many a gentle person made a jack.
Come, we know your meaning, Brother Gloucester. You envy my advancement and my friends. God grant we never may have need of you.
Oh, meantime, God grants that I have need of you. My brother is imprisoned by your means.
I never did incense his majesty against the Duke of Clarence, but have been an earnest advocate to plead for him.
Oh, you may deny that you are not the cause of my lord Hastings' late imprisonment.
She may, my lord.
She may do more, sir, than deny that. Oh, what? May she not? She may, yea, marry me.
What marry may she?
What marry may she? Marry with a king. A bachelor, a handsome stripling, too.
My lord of Gloucester, I have too long borne your blunt upbraidings and your bitter scoffs. By heaven, I will acquaint his majesty with those gross taunts I often have endured. Small joy have I in being England's queen.
And lessened being that small god, I beseech him, thy honor, state, and seat is due to me.
What? Threaten me with telling of the king? Well, tell him and spare not. Look, what I have said, I will avouch in presence of the king. 'Tis time to speak, my pains are quite forgot.
Out! Devil, I remember them too well. Thou slewest my husband Henry in the tower, and Edward, my poor son, at Tewkesbury.
Ere you were queen, yea, and your husband king, I was pathos in his great affairs. The royalizer's blood has spilt my own.
Aye, and much better blood than his or thine.
In all which time you were fatuous with the house of Lancaster. But let me put in your minds, lest you forget, what you have been ere now, and what you are, with all what I have been, and what I am.
A murderous villain, and so still thou art.
But poor Clarence did forsake his vow to Warwick, yea, and forswore himself, which James
Hawkins,
to fight on Edward's party for the crown. And for his mead, poor lord, he is mewed up. I would to God my heart were flint like Edward's, or Edward soft and pitiful like mine. I am too childish, foolish for this world.
My lord Gloucester, in those busy days which here you urged to do as enemies, we followed then our lord, our lawful king. So should we you if you should be our king.
If I should be king, I'd rather be a peddler. Far be it from my heart the thought of it.
Hear me, you wrangling pirates that fall out in sharing that which you have killed from me. Which of you trembles not that looks on me? If not that I am queen, you bow like subjects. Yet that by you depose, you quit like rebels. Gentle villain, do not turn away.
That wrinkled witch! What makest thou in my sight?
A repetition of what thou hast marred, that will I make before I let thee go.
Banish some pain of death.
I was, but I do find more pain in banishment than death can yield me here by my abode. A husband and a son thou owest to me, and thou a kingdom. All of you allegiance. This sorrow that I have by right is yours, and all the pleasures you deserve are mine.
The curse my noble father laid on me, when thou didst crown his warlike brows with paper, and with thy scorns drewest rivers from his eyes, and then, to dry them, gavest the Duke a clout, steeped in the faultless blood of pretty Rutland. His curses then from bitterness of soul denounced on thee are all fallen upon thee, and God, not we, plague thy bloody deed.
So just is God to right the innocent.
For the foulest deed to slay that babe, and the most merciless that ever was heard of.
Tyrants himself wept when it was reported. No man will prophesy revenge for it.
What? Were you snarling all before I came, ready to catch each other by the throat, and turn you all your hatred now on me? In York's dread curse prevails so much with heaven that Henry's death, my lovely Edward's death, their kingdom's loss, my woeful banishment could all but answer for that peevish rat, and curses pierce the clouds and enter heaven. Why then give way, dull clouds, to my quick curses. If not by war, by servant, thy your king, as ours by murder to make you a king. Edward thy son, that now is Prince of Wales, for Edward my son that was Prince of Wales, die in his by like untimely violence. Thyself a queen, for me that was a queen, outlive thy glory like my wretched self, and die neither mother, wife, nor England's queen. Dorset and Hastings, you were standers by when my son was stabbed with bloody daggers. God, I pray that none of you may live your natural age, but by some unlooked accident, cut.
Have done thy charm, thou hateful withered hag.
And leave out thee. Stay, dog, for thou shalt hear me. If heaven have any grievous plague in store, exceeding those that I can wish upon thee, oh, let them keep it till thy sins be ripe, and then hurl down their indignation on thee, the troubler of the poor world's peace. Thy friends suspect for traitors while thou livest, and take deep traitors for thy dearest friends, thou elvish mark and god of rooting hog. Thou, that was sealed in thy nativity, the slave of nature and the son of hell. Thou rag of honor, thou detested
Margaret.
Richard! Ha! I call thee not.
Well, then I cry thee mercy, though. For I had thought that thou wouldst call me on these bitter names.
Why, so I did, but looked for no reply. Oh, let me make the period to my curse.
'Tis done by me, and ends in Margaret.
Thus have you breathed your curse against yourself.
Poor, painted queen, vain flourish of my fortune, why strewest thou sugar on that bottled spider whose deadly web ensnareth thee, a fount fool? Fool! Thou wouldst about to kill thyself. The time will come when thou shalt wish for me to help thee curse that poisonous bunchback toad.
Have done, have done!
Oh, and sleep again. I'll kiss thy hand in sign of league and amity with thee. Now fare befall thee and thy noble house. Thy garments are not spotted with our blood, nor thou within the compass of my curse.
Nor no one here, for curses never pass the lips of those that breathe them in the air.
I'll not believe the day that's in the sky. And there awake God's gentle, sleeping peace. Take heed of yonder dog, when he fawns, he bites, and when he bites, his venom tooth will rankle to the death. Have not to do with him, beware of him. Sin, death, and hell have set their marks on him and all their ministers. Attend on him.
What doth she say, my lord of Buckingham?
Nothing that I respect, my gracious lord.
What dost thou scorn me for my gentle counsel? Oh, think of this another day. When he shall split thy very heart with sorrow, and say poor Margaret is upon us. Let each of you the subjects to his hate, and he to yours, and all of you to God's!
I can't stand on end to hear her curses.
Looked off my eyes while she's at liberty.
I never did her any to my knowledge.
Yet you have all the vantage of her wrong. Marry, as for Clarence, he is well repaid. Cranked up a fathom for his pains.
Lords, will you go with us?
Madam, we will attend you.
How now, my hearty stout resolved mates? Art thou now going to dispatch the deed?
We are, my lord, and come to have the warrant that we may be admitted to where he is.
Oh, well thought upon, I have it here about me. But, sirs, be sudden in thy execution. With all abjuring, do not hear him speak. For Clarence is well spoken, and perhaps may move your hearts to pity if you not.
Hush. Fear not, my lord. We will not stand afraid. Talkers are no good doers. Be assured, we come to use our hands and not our tongues.
I like you, lads. Well, about your business straight. Go, go.
We will, my noble lord. Why looks your grace so heavily today?
Oh, I have passed a miserable night, so full of ugly sights, of ghastly dreams, that as I am a Christian faithful man, I would not spend another such a night, though 'twere to buy a world of happy days, so full of dismal terror was the time.
What was your dream? I long to hear you tell it.
Methought that I had broken from the tower, and was in arms across the Bergen. And in my company, my brother Gloucester, from my cabin tempted me to walk upon the hatches. As we paced along upon the giddy footing of the hatches, methought that Gloucester stumbled, and in falling, struck me that thought to stay him overboard into the tumbling billows of the main. Lord, Lord, methought what pain it was to drown. What dreadful noise of water in mine ears, what ugly sights of death within mine eyes. Methought I saw 1,000 fearful wrecks, 10,000 men that fishes not upon wedges of gold, great anchors, heaps of pearl, inestimable stones, unvalued
jewels all scattered on the bottom of the sea. Some lay in dead men's skulls, and in those holes where eyes did once inhabit, now were crept, as if in scorn of eyes, reflecting gems that glued the slimy bottom of the deep and mocked the dead bones that lay scattered by.
Had you such leisure at the time of death to gaze upon the secrets of the deep?
And methought I had, and often did I strive to yield the ghost, but still the envious flood kept in my soul and would not let it forth.
Awake you not with this sore agony?
Oh no. No, my dream was lengthened after life. Oh, then began the tempest to my soul, and past me thought the melancholy flood with that grim ferryman which poets write of unto the kingdom of perpetual night. The curse that there did grieve my stranger soul was my great father-in-law, renowned Warwick, who cried aloud, "What scourge for perjury can this dark monarchy afford false Clarence? Seize on him, Duras! Take him to your torments!" With that methought a legion of foul fiends environed me about and howled in mine ears such hideous cries that with the very noise I trembling wakened and for a season after could not believe but that I was in hell. Such terrible impression made the dream.
No marvel, my lord, though it affrighted you, I promise I am afraid to hear you tell it.
Oh, Catesby, I have done those things that now bear evidence against my soul for Edward's sake. And see how he requites me. I pray thee, gentle keeper, stay by me. My soul is heavy, and thy fain would sleep.
I will, my good lord. God give your grace good rest. Sorrow breaks seasons and reposing hours, makes the night morning and the noontide night.
Oh, who's there?
Godfrey, what are you and how came you hither?
I was speaking to Clarence, and I came hither on my legs.
Show him our commission, talk no more. I am, in this, commanded to deliver the noble Duke of Clarence to your hands. I will not reason what is meant hereby, because I will be guiltless of the meaning.
It is a point of wisdom.
Very well.
What, shall we stab him as he sleeps?
No, then he will say 'twas done cowardly when he wakes.
When he wakes, why fool, he will never wake till the judgment day.
Why, then he will say we stabbed him sleeping.
The urging of that word judgment hath bred a kind of remorse in me.
What? I'm afraid.
Not to kill him, having a warrant for it, but to be damned for killing him, from which no warrant can defend us.
I thought thou hadst been resolute.
So I am, to let him live.
Back to the Duke of Glasgow.
I pray thee, stay a while. I hope thy holy humor will change. 'Twas wont to hold me but while one would tell 20.
How dost thou feel thyself now?
Faith, there are some certain dregs of conscience yet within me.
Remember our reward for the deeds done.
Zounds, he dies, I had forgotten about the reward.
There's thy conscience.
In the Duke of Gloucester's purse. Come, shall we do this gear? Oh, excellent device. Make a sop of him.
Mark, is your device right?
No, first let's reason with him.
Where art thou, keeper? Give me a cup of wine.
You shall have wine enough, my lord, anon.
In God's name, what art thou?
A man, as you are.
But not as I am royal.
Nor you, as we are loyal.
Wherefore do you come?
To
murder me?
Aye.
You scarcely have the hearts to tell me so, and therefore cannot have the hearts to do it. Where, my friends, have I offended you?
Offended us, you have not.
I shall be reconciled to him again.
Never again. Therefore prepare to die, my lord.
I charge you, as you hope to have redemption, by Christ's dear blood shed for our grievous sins, that you depart and lay no hands on me. The deed you undertake is damnable.
What we do upon command.
And he that hath commanded is the king.
Erroneous answer. The great king of kings hath in the tables of his law commanded that thou shalt do no murder. And wilt thou yet spurn at his edict to fulfill a man's? Think he, for he holds vengeance in his hands to hurl on their heads that break his law.
And that same charge doth he hurl on thee. For false forswearing and for murder, too.
How canst thou urge God's dreadful law to us when thou hast broken in so dear degree?
A
Alas, for whose sake did I that ill deed? For Edward's? For my brother's? For his sake? Oh, I say, he sends you not to murder me for this. For in this sin he is as deep as I. If he be hired for me to go back again, then I will send you to my brother Gloucester, who will reward you better for my life than Edward will for tidings of my death.
You are deceived. Your brother Gloucester hates you.
Do not slander him, for he is kind.
Right, as snow and harvest. Thou deceivest thyself. Tis he that sent the citadel to slaughter thee.
When I parted with him, he hugged me in his arms and he swore with sobs to labor my delivery.
And so he doth. Now he delivers thee from this world's thraldom to the joys of heaven.
Make peace with God, for you must die, my lord.
Hast thou that holy feeling in thy soul to counsel me to make peace with God? And art thou yet to thine own soul so blind that thou wilt war with God by murdering me?
What shall we do?
Relent and save your souls. My friend, I spy some beauty in thy looks. For if thine eye be not a flatterer, come thou on my side and entreat for me as you would beg were you in my distress. A begging prince, what beggar pities that?
Look behind you, my lord.
Take that, and that's what all this will not do. I'll drown you in the mud as they quack within.
Oh, bloody deed, desperately dispatched. How fain would I have it when I wash my hands of this most grievous guilty murder blood.
Why so now have I done a good day's work? You peers continue this united league. I every day expected a message from my Redeemer to redeem me, and now in peace my soul shall part to heaven, since I've set my friends at peace on earth. Dorset, Hastings, take each other's hand. Dissemble not your hatred. Swear your love.
By heaven, my heart is purged from grudging me. With my hand I seal my true heart's love. So thrive I, as I truly swear the life.
Adam, yourself are not exempt in this.
Here, Hastings, I will nevermore remember our former hatred, so thrive I and mine.
Now, princely Buckingham, seal thou this league with thy embracements to my wife's allies, and make me happy in your unity.
Ever Buckingham doth turn his gate on you or yours, who with all duteous love doth cherish you and yours. I pray God punish me in hate and those where I expect most love.
Pleasing to all, O princely Buckingham, is this thy vow unto my sacred heart.
Good morrow to my sovereign king and queen, and princely peers, a happy time of day.
Happy indeed as we have spent the day. Brother, redone deeds of charity, may peace, enmity, fair love of hate between these swelling, wrong, incensed peers.
A blessed labor, my most sovereign liege. Well, if I, unwittingly or in my rage, have aught committed that which is hardly borne by any in his royal presence, I do desire to reconcile me to his friendly peace. 'Tis death to me to be at enmity. I hate it, and desire all good men's love. First, madam, I entreat true peace of you. And you, my cousin of Buckingham, if ever any grudge were lodged between us. Well, I do not know the Englishman alive with whom my soul is any jot at odds. More so than the infant that is born tonight, I thank my God for my humility.
A holy day shall this be kept hereafter. My sovereign liege, I do beseech your majesty to take our brother Clarence to your grace.
But madam, have I offered love for this to be so bouted in your royal presence? Who knows not that the noble duke is dead?
Who knows not he is dead? Who knows he is?
All seeing heaven, what world is this?
Is Clarence dead? The order was reversed.
But he by your first order died. And that a winged messenger did bear, some tardy cripple bore the countermand, came too lag to see him buried.
A boon, my sovereign, my service done.
I pray thee, peace. My soul is full of sorrow.
I will not rise unless your highness grant.
Then speak at once. What is it thou demandest?
The forfeit, sovereign, of my servant's life. And so today a righteous gentleman lately attended on the Duke of Norfolk.
Have I a tongue to doom my brother's death? And shall the same give pardon to a slave? Who sued to me for him? who in my rage kneeled at my feet and bade me be advised, who spake of brotherhood, who spake of love, who told me in the field by Tewkesbury when Oxford had me down, he rescued me and said, dear brother, live and be a king. Who told me when we both lay in the field, frozen, almost to death, how he did lap me, even in his own garments, and gave himself all thin and naked to the numb cold night? All this for my remembrance, brutish wrath, sinfully plucked. Another man of you had so much grace to put it in my mind. But when your carters, or your waiting vassals, have done a drunken slaughter and defaced the precious image of our dear Redeemer, you strain on your knees for pardon, pardon. And I, unjustly too, must grant it you. But for my brother, not a man would speak. Nor I, ungracious, speak unto myself for him, poor soul. The proudest of you all have been beholden to him in his life. Yet none of you would once plead for his life. Oh God, I fear thy justice will take hold on me. And you and mine, and yours for this. Come, Dawson, up into my closet. Oh, Clarence.
This is the fruit of rashness. Far do not have that the guilty kindred of the queen looked pale when they did hear of Clarence's death. Both did urge it still unto the king. God will avenge it. But come. Let us in to comfort Edward with our company.
We wait upon your grace.
Oh, who shall hinder me to wail and weep, to try my fortune and torment myself? I'll join with black despair against my soul and to myself become an enemy. What means this scene of rude impatience? Edward, my lord, your son, our king, is dead. Why grow the branches now the root is withered? Why wither not the leaves, the sap being gone? So much interest have I in thy sorrow as I had title in thy noble husband. I had bewept a worthy husband's death and lived by looking on his images. But now, two mirrors of his princely semblance are cracked in pieces by malignant death, and I, for comfort, have but one false glass. Grieves me when I see my shame in him. Edward and Clarence, what cause have I, thy me but a moiety of my grief, to overgo thy plaints and drown thy cries?
Oh, for my husband, for my dear lord Edward.
Alas, for both mine, Edward and Clarence.
What stay had I but Edward, and he's gone?
What stays had I but they, and they are gone?
Was never widow had so dear a loss.
Was never mother had so dear a loss. Alas, I'm the mother of these bones. She for Edward weeps, and so do I. I for Clarence weep, so doth not she. Alas, pour all your tears on me. I am your sorrow's nurse, and I will pamper lamentations.
Madam, I think you are the careful mother of the young sincere son. Send straight for him, let him be crowned. And here your comfort lives. Found this in sorrow and that Edward's grief, and great joy in living at this throne.
Madam, comfort. All of us have cause to wail the dimming of our shining star, but none can cure their harms by wailing then.
Madam, my mother, I cry thee mercy. Humbly on my knee, I beg thy blessing.
God bless thee, and put meekness in thy mind. Love, charity, obedience, and true duty.
Amen. And make me die a good old man. That is the butt end of a mother's blessing. I do marvel why her grace did leave it out.
You cloudy princes in heart sorrowing peers, though we have spent the harvest of this king, we reap the harvest of his son. We see with good with some little train forthwith from Ludlow, the young prince be fetched hither to London to be crowned our king.
Let be it so. And go we to determine who they shall be that straight shall post to Ludlow. Madam, and you, my mother, will you go to give your censures in this weighty business?
With all our hearts.
My lord, whoever journeys to the prince, for God's sake, let us two be not behind. For by the way, I'll sword occasion to part the queen's proud kindred from the king.
My other self, my oracle, my prophet. My dear cousin, I, like a child, will go by thy direction.
Last night, I hear they lay at Northampton. At Stony Stratford will they be tonight, tomorrow, or next day they will be here.
I long with all my heart to see the prince. I hope he has not grown since last I saw him.
But I hear no. They say my son of York hath almost o'erta'en him in his growth.
Aye, mother, but I will not have it so. Why, my young cousin, it is good to grow.
My uncle Gloucester says, small herbs have grapes, great weeds to grow apiece.
He was the wretchedest thing when he was young, so long a-growing and so leisurely, that if this rule were true, he should be gracious.
Mary, they say my uncle grew so fast, that he could not first say 2 hours old.
I pray thee, pretty York, who told thee this?
Grandam, his nurse.
His nurse! Why, she was dead ere thou wert born.
Swear not, she. I cannot tell who told me. A parlous boy. Go to. You are too shrewd.
Oh, good madam, be not angry with the child.
Pitchers have ears.
Here comes Dorset. What news?
Such news, madam, as brings me to unfold.
How fares the prince?
Well, mother.
What is thy news, then?
Lord Rivers and Lord Grey have been sent to Pomfret. My brother and my uncle prisoners.
Who hath committed them?
My Duke's Gloucester and Buckingham.
Oh, me. I see the downfall of our house. Tiger now hath seized the gentle hind. I see, as in a map, the end of all. Come, come, my boy, we will to sanctuary. Madam, farewell.
I'll go along with you.
You have no cause.
My gracious lady, go, and thither bear your treasure and jewels. Cursed and unquiet wrangling days. How many of you have mine eyes beheld? My husband lost his life to get the crown. And often up and down my sons were tossed for me to joy and weep their gain and loss, and being seated and domestic broils clean overblown, themselves the conquerors make war upon themselves. Blood against blood, self against self. Oh, preposterous and frantic outrage, end thy damned spleen. Oh, let me die to look on death no more.
Welcome, sweet prince, to London.
Welcome, dear cousin.
Well, my fond sovereign, the weary way hath made you melancholy.
No, uncle, but our crosses on the way have made it tedious, wearisome, and heavy. I want more uncles here to welcome me.
Well, those uncles which you want were dangerous. God keep you from them, from such false friends.
God keep me from false friends, but they were not.
Well, my lord, the mayor of London comes to greet you.
God bless your grace with health and happy days.
I thank you, good my lord, and thank you all. I thought my mother and my brother York would long ere this had met us on the way. Welcome, my lord. What will our mother come?
On what occasion, God knows, not I. The queen, your mother, and the younger York have taken sanctuary. The tender prince would have fain come with me to meet your grace, but by his mother was perforce withheld.
Fie! What an indirect and peevish course is this averse. My lord bishop, will your grace persuade the queen to send the Duke of York unto his princely brother presently? She deny Lord Hastings go with him, and from her jealous arms pluck him perforce.
My lord of Buckingham, God in heaven forbid we should infringe the holy privilege of blessed sanctuary.
Weigh it but with the grossest of this age. You break not sanctuary in seizing him, the benefit of which is always given to those whose dealings have deserved the place. This prince has neither claimed it nor deserved it, and therefore, in my opinion, cannot have it. Oft have I heard of sanctuary men, but sanctuary children? Ne'er till now.
My lord, you shall overrule my mind for once. Come on, Lord Hastings, will you go with me?
I go, my lord.
Where should we sojourn till our coronation?
Well, where seems best unto your royal self. If I may counsel you, some day or two your highness shall repose you at the Tower.
I do not like the Tower of any place. Did Julius Caesar build that place, my lord?
He did, my lord, begin that place, which since succeeding ages have re-edified.
Is it, upon record or else reported successively from age to age, he built it?
On record, my gracious lord.
But say, my lord, if we're not registered, methinks the troops should live from age to age.
So I, so young, they say. You never live long.
And now in good time here comes the Duke of York.
Richard of York, how fares our lovely brother?
Well, my dread lord, so must I call you now? Aye, brother, to our grief as it is yours.
Fares my noble lord of York.
I thank you, gentlemen. I pray, Waldo, give me this dagger.
Oh, you have my weapon, little lord.
I would that I might thank you as you call me.
How?
Little.
My lord of York will still be cross and talk until your grace has had a bear with him.
You mean to bear me, not to bear with me. Uncle, my brother mocks both you and me, but I am little like an ape. He thinks that you should bear me on your shoulders.
Well, my cousin, will you go along? Myself and my cousin of Buckingham will to your mother, to entreat her to come to the tower and to join you.
I shall not sit quiet at the tower.
Why? What should you fear?
Mary, my Uncle Clarence, angry ghost. My grand-aunt told me he was murdered there.
I fear no uncle's dead. No more none that live, I hope. And if they live, I hope I need not fear.
Let them rest. Come hither, Catesby. Thou art sworn as deeply to effect what we intend, as closely conceal what we impart. What thinkst thou? Will it not be an easy matter to win William Lord Hastings to our mind for the installment of this noble duke in the seat royal of this famous isle?
He, for his father's sake, so loves the prince that he will not be won to aught against him.
But if Stanley, what will he?
Oh, he will do all in all as Hastings doth.
Well, then, no more than this. Go, gently, Hastings, yeah. As if far off, sound Lord Hastings. How does he stand affected to our purpose? And summon him to the tower tomorrow to sit about the coronation. If he be leaden, ice cold, unwilling, be thou so too, and break off talk and give us notice of his inclination.
Tell him, Catesby, that his ancient knot of dangerous adversaries tomorrow are let blood at Pomfret Castle.
Go, Catesby, go. Effect this business soundly.
My good lords both, I go with all the heed I may.
My lord, what shall we do if we perceive that Lord Hastings will not yield to our device?
Chop off his head, man. So what we will do. And look, when I am king, claim thou of me the earldom of Hereford, and all the movables whereof the king my brother stood possessed.
I'll claim that promise in your grace's hands.
And look to have it yielded with all willingness.
I did dream today that the boar did raise his helm, and would know thy lordship's pleasure, that would hide the force and fly with me to the north to shun the present danger that my soul divines. His fears are shallow, wanting instance. As for dreams, I'm curious to trust the mockery of unquiet slumbers. To fly the boar before the boar pursues would be to incense the boar to give pursuit where he did mean no chase.
Many good morrows to my noble lord.
Good morrow, Catesby, thou art early stirring. What news? What news in this our tottering state, huh?
Tis the reeling world indeed, my lord, and I believe 'twill never stand upright till Richard wear the garland of the realm.
The garland? Does that mean the crown?
Aye, my good lord.
Oh, I will see this crown of mine cut from my shoulders ere I see the royal crown so foully misplaced. But yes, I need a name at it.
Aye, on my life, and hopes to find you forward upon his party for the game thereof. And thereupon he sends you this good news that the same very day your enemies, the kindred of the queen, must die at Pomfret.
Oh, I'm no mourner for that news, for they have still been mine enemies. But to give my voice on Richard's side to bar the true descent of my master's heirs, that I shall not do even to my own death.
God keep your lordship in that gracious mind.
I shall laugh at this a 12 months hence, and those that have put me in my master's hate, I shall live to see their tragedy.
'Tis a vile thing to die, my lord, when men are unprepared and look not for it.
Monstrous, monstrous, but so it falls out with rivers and with gray. Go you to the tower.
I'll wait upon your lordship.
Come on, where is thy boar spear, man? Fear you the boar and go so unprovided, huh?
My lord, good morrow, Catesby. You may jest on, but by the holy rood, I do not like these subtle counsels that I
hold. My lord, I hold my life as dear as you do yours, perhaps even more so in this present time. But do you not think that I know our state secure? I would be as triumphant as I am.
Your thoughts of Pomfret when they rode from London were jocund. I suppose their state for sure, they indeed had no cause to distrust. But yet, you see how soon the day are cast.
Come, my lords, we are here for the cause of the coronation. In God's name, speak. When is the royal day?
Are all things fitting for that royal time?
It is, and once but nomination.
Tomorrow, then, I judge a happy day.
Who knows the Lord Protector's mind herein? Who is most inward with the royal duke?
Your grace, we think, should soonest know his mind.
We know each other's faces, but as for our hearts, he knows no more of mine than I of yours. Lord Hastings, you and he are near in love.
I thank your grace, yes. I know he loves me well, but as for the coronation, he hath neither sounded me nor given his pleasure on the matter. But if your lordships will name the day and the time, I will give my voice on the Duke's behalf, which I presume he will take in gentle part.
Now in good time. Here comes the Duke himself.
My noble lords and cousins all, good morrow. I have been long asleep, but I hope my absence doth neglect no great designs, which by my presence might have been concluded.
Had you not come to our cue, my lord, William Lord Hastings was to pronounce your part. I mean your voice for the crowning of the king.
But my lord Hastings, no man may be bolder. His lordship knows me well, and loves me well. My lord of Ely, when last I was in Holborn, I saw good strawberries in your garden. I do beseech you send for some of them.
Oh, marry and will, my lord, with all my heart.
Cousin of Buckingham, who heard of you?
Hastie hath sounded Hastings in our designs, and finds the testy gentleman so hot, as he will lose his head ere he'll consent.
So draw you hence, my lord, I'll follow.
I have not yet set down this day of triumph. Tomorrow, in my opinion, is too soon.
I have set for these strawberries.
My chief, my grace is cheerful and smooth today. I do believe there is some conceit or other that likes him well. I believe there is no man in Christendom who can less hide his love or his hate than he, for by his face straight shall you know his heart.
What if his heart will see you in his face by any likelihood of showing
it? No man here is he offended, for if he were, you would know it by his looks.
I pray you all, tell me what they deserve, that do conspire my death with plots of damned witchcraft, and have prevailed upon my body with their hellish charms.
Well, I bear, my lord, makes me bold in your noble presence to doom the offenders, whatsoever they may be. I say, my lord, they deserve death.
Then be your eyes the witness of this ill. See how I am bewitched. Behold, my arm is like a blasted sapling withered up. And this is Edward's wife, that monstrous witch that by her witchcraft thus hath marked me.
She hath done this thing, my lord.
If thou protector of this damned strumpet, tellest thou me of ifs? Thou art a traitor. Off with his head! Now, by St. Paul, I swear, I will not die until I see the same. Ratcliffe, look that it be done. The rest that love me, rise and follow me.
Oh, for England, not a whip from me, for I too dully have prevented this. Stanley did dream that the board had raised his helm, and I did scorn it and disdain to fly.
For Margaret, now thy heavy curses have landed on poor Hastings' wretched head.
Dispatch, my lord. The Duke could be at dinner. Make a short shrift, he longs to see your head.
A momentary grace of mortal man, that which we look for more than the grace of God. Sits on the mast like a drunken sailor, with each cold nod, looks deeper into the bowels of the sea.
Come, come, dispatch, 'tis bootless to exclaim. Bloody Richard!
Oh, miserable England. I prophesy the wretchedest time for thee that age ever did look upon. Come, lead me to the block. Bear him my head, they smile at me. Shortly shall be dead.
So dear, I love the man that I must weep. I took him for the plainest, harmless creature that ever breathed upon this earth, a Christian.
Well, he was the covertest, sheltered traitor that ever lived. Would you imagine or almost believe, were it not by great preservation we live tell you, this subtle traitor had plotted this day in the council house to murder me and my good lord of Gloucester?
What? Had he so?
What? Think you we are Turks or infidels? Or that we would, against the form of law, proceed thus rashly to the villain's death? But that the extremest peril of the case, the peace of England and our person's safety, enforced us to this execution.
Now, fair before you, he deserved his death, and you, my good lords, both have well proceeded to warn false traitor from the attempt. I'll acquaint our duty citizens with all your just proceedings in this place.
In
In that matter, we wish your lordship here
to avoid the carping censures of the world.
And so, my good lord, we bid farewell.
Go after Buckingham. The mayor towards Guildhall hides in the outpost, and there, at the neatest advantage of the time, infer the bastardy of Edward's children. Moreover, urge his hateful luxury and change of lust. Tell them that when my mother went with child of that insatiate Edward, the noble duke, my princely father, then had wars in France, and by just computation of the time, found that the issue was not his begot. But touch this sparingly, as 'twere far off, because you know, my lord, my mother lives.
Fear not, my lord. I'll play the orator as though the golden feet for which I plead were for myself. And so, my lord, have you.
If you thrive well, bring them to Baynard's castle. Now, my lord, what say the citizens?
The citizens are mum and speak not a word.
Well, touched you, Theo, the bastardy of Edward's children.
I did by his contract with Lady Lucy, the insatiate greediness of his desires, his tyranny for trifles, his own bastardy as being got your father then in France, and in resemblance being not like the Duke. Moreover, I did it for your limits as being the right idea of your father, both in your form and nobleness of mind, your discipline in war, your wisdom in peace, your bounty, your virtue, your fair humility. And when my oratory grew to an end, I bid those that did love their country's good cry, God save Richard, England's royal king!
Oh, did they so?
No, so help me God. Mum and spake not a word. Then at my sign, some followers of mine own at the lower end of the hall threw their caps in the air, and some 10 voices cried out, God save King Richard. Thus I seized the vantage of those few. Thanks, gentle citizens and friends, quoth I. Your general applause and loving shout argues your wisdoms and your love for Richard, and even then break off and came away.
What tongueless blocks were they! But what? Will not the mayor then and his brethren come?
The mayor is at hand, intends some fear. Be not spoke with but by mighty suit, and see you get a prayer book in your hands. Be not easily won to our request. Play the maid's part, still answer nay, and take it!
I go. And if you plead as well for them as I can say nay to thee for myself, no doubt we'll bring it to a happy
end. Welcome, my lord. I dance attendance here. I think his grace will not be spoke withal. Oh, here's a servant. Catesby, how does his lord, his grace?
My lord, he doth entreat your grace to visit him tomorrow or next day. He is within. Two right reverend fathers, divinely bent to meditation, and no worldly suit would he be moved to draw him from his holy exercise.
Return, Catesby, to thy lord. Tell him myself, the mayor, and citizens are coming to have some conference with his grace.
I'll tell him what you say, though.
This prince is not an Edward. He's not lolling about on some lewd daybed, but on his knees in meditation. Happy were England when this gracious prince should take upon himself the sovereignty thereof. Sure, I fear we shall never win into it.
Marry, God forbid his gracious say his nay.
I fear he will.
Oh, see where he stands.
Yes, see, a book of prayer in his hand. True ornament to know a holy man. Famous Plantagenet, most noble prince. Lend favorable ears to our request, and pardon us the disruption of thy devotion and right Christian zeal.
Oh, my lord, there needs no such apology. I rather do beseech you pardon me, who, earnest in the service of my God, neglect the visitation of my friends. But, well, don't you suspect I have done some offense that seems disgracious in the city's eyes, and that you come to reprehend my ignorance?
Your fault is that you resigned the sceptered office of your ancestors to the corruption of a blemished stock, which to recure we heartily solicit your gracious self take on you the charge and kingly government of this your land, not as protector, steward, substitute, but successively, blood to blood, your right of birth, your empery, your own. And in this just suit, come we hither to move your grace.
Alas, why would you lay these cares upon me? I am unfit for state and majesty. I cannot, I will not yield to you.
If you refuse, in love and honor, loath to depose the child, your brother's son, yet know that whether you accept our suit or no, your brother's son shall never reign our king. Rather, we will put some other on the throne to the disgrace and downfall in your house. And in this resolution here we leave you, zounds, I'll entreat no more.
Do not swear, my lord of Buckingham.
My lord, call them again and accept their suit.
Do good, my lord, lest all the land do rue it.
Would you enforce me to a world of care? Well, call them again. I am not made of stone, but penetrable to your kind entreats. My noble cousin, and you, sage, grave men, since you will buckle fortune on my back, to bear her burden whether I will or no, I must have patience to endure the load. For God, he knows, and you may partly see, just how far I am from the desire thereof.
Oh, God bless your grace. We see it, and we'll say it.
Then I salute your grace with this kingly title. Long live Richard, England's royal king.
Amen!
Tomorrow will it please your grace to be crowned?
Even if it please you, since you will have it so.
Tomorrow we will attend upon your grace, and so joyfully we take our leave.
Oh. Well, come, gentlemen, to our holy task again. Farewell, my noble cousin. Farewell, gentle friends.
The Lord Protector.
The Lord protect him from that kingly title, hath he set bounds betwixt their love and me. I am their mother, who should keep me from them.
I am their father's mother. I will see them.
No, madam, no, I may not leave it so. I am bound by oath, and therefore, pardon me.
Let me but meet your ladies 1 hour hence, and I will salute your Grace of Dorcas, mother, and Reverend Looker on of two fair twins. Come, go straight to Westminster. There to be crowned Richard's royal queen.
Oh, cut my lace in sunder that my pent heart may have some scope to beat, or else I swoon with this dead killing news.
Spiteful tidings, oh, unpleasing news!
Good cheer, mother, here's your grace.
Oh, Joseph, speak not to me, get thee hence. If thou wilt outstrip death, go cross the seas and live with Richmond from the reach of hell. Go, hide thee from this slaughterhouse, lest thou increase the number of the dead.
Full of wise care, resist your counsel, madam. Take all swift advantage of the hours. You shall have letters from me to my son, to meet you on the way.
Oh, ill-dispersing wind of misery, my cursed womb, the bed of death.
Come, madam, come, in all haste with sense.
And I, in all unwillingness, will go. Anointed, let me be with deadly venom, and die ere man can say, God save the queen.
Go, poor soul. I envy not thy glory to feed my humor. Wish thyself no harm.
When he that is my husband outfaked me, when scarce the blood was well washed from his hands, which issued from my other angel husband, in that dead scene which then I weep and followed, oh, when I say, I looked on Richard's face, this was my wish. Get out, quoth I, accursed for making me so young, so old, a widow. Indeed I like. If any be so mad, as miserable by the life of thee as thou hast made me by my dear lord's death. Lo, ere I can repeat this curse again, for even in so short a space my woman's heart closely grew captive to his honey words, and proved the subject of my own soul's curse. For never yet 1 hour in his bed have I enjoyed the golden dew of sleep that had been leaked by his timorous streams.
Poor heart, adieu. I pity thy complaining.
No more than for my soul, I mourn for yours.
Farewell, Farewell, thou woeful welcomer of glory.
Do, poor soul, that takest thy leave.
Go thou to Richmond, and good fortune guide thee. Go thou to Richmond, and good angels guard thee. Go thou to sanctuary, and good thoughts possess thee. Light my grave, peace and rest will I give thee.
Stay, yet look back with me unto the tower. Pity you ancient stones, those tender babes whom envy hath immured within your walls. Rough cradles are such filthy ones. Rude, ragged nurse, old sullen clay fellow for tender princes, use my babies well. So foolish sorrow bids your stones farewell.
Are you doing?
No, I'm not.
Please.
Stand all apart, cousin of Buckingham.
My gracious sovereign.
Give me thy hand. Thus high, by thy advice and thy assistance, is King Richard seated. But shall we wear these honors for a day? Or shall they last and we rejoice in them?
Still live then, forever may they last.
Oh, Buckingham. Now do I play the touch. Try if thou be current gold in me. Young Edward lives. Think now what I would say.
So, my loving lord.
Why, Buckingham, I say I would be king.
Why, so you are, my thrice-renowned liege.
Ha! Am I king? But Edward lives.
True, noble prince.
Cousin, I would not want to be so dull. Shall I be plain? I wish the bastard's dead, and I would have it suddenly performed. But what thinkest thou? Speak suddenly, be brief.
Your grace may do your pleasure.
Oh, tut, tut, thou art all ice, thy kindness freezeth. Say, have I thy consent that they shall die?
Give me some breath, some little pause, my lord, before I speak positively this way. Resolve your grace in me.
I will consult with iron-witted fools and unrespected boys. None are for me that look into me with considerate eyes. I wish in Buckingham grows circumspect. Ratcliffe.
My lord.
Knowest thou not any whom corrupting gold might tempt into a close exploit of death?
My lord, I know a discontented gentleman. Gold, no doubt, tempted to anything.
And what's his name?
His name, my lord, is Tyrell.
Ah, call him thither. The deep revolving, witty Buckingham no more shall be the neighbor to my counsel. Hath he held out with me for so long, and stops he now for breath? How now? What news with you?
My lord, I had an Archie Dorset fled to Richmond.
Catesby,
my lord.
Rumor it abroad that Anne, my wife, is sick and like to die. I will take order for her keeping close. Why, look how thou dreamest. I say again, give out that Anne, my wife, is sick and like to die. About it! Be married to my brother's daughter, or my kingdom stands on brittle glass. Murder her brothers and then marry her. Uncertain way of gain. Land shall far and blood a sin will pluck on sin. Tear falling pity dwells not in this eye. Is thy name Tyrell?
Sir James Tyrell, and your most obedient subject.
Well, art thou indeed?
Prove me, my gracious sovereign.
Well, darest thou resolve to kill a friend of mine?
Aye, my lord, but I had rather kill two enemies.
Why, there thou hast it. Two deep enemies. Foes to my rest and my sweet sleep's disturbers. Tyrell, I mean those bastards in the tower.
Give me means to come to them, and soon I'll rid you from the fear of them.
Ah, well, now sing a sweet music. Well, come hither. Go by this token. Say it is done, and I will love thee, and prefer thee to.
It is done, my gracious sovereign.
My lord, I have considered my mind the late demand that you did sound me in.
Well, at that patch, Dorset has fled to Richmond.
I hear that news, my lord.
Stanley, Richmond is your wife's son. Well, look unto it.
My lord, I claim your gift, my due by promise, to which your honor and faith is pawned. The Earldom of Hereford and the movables the which you promised I should possess.
Stanley, look to your wife.
she convey letters to Richmond, you shall answer to it.
What does your highness say to my just demand?
As I recall, Henry VI did prophesy that Richmond would be king when Richmond was a little peevish boy. A king, perhaps. Perhaps.
My lord.
How could that not the prophet at that time have told me, I mean by, that I should kill him?
My lord, your promise were the earldom.
Oh, Richmond. What's o'clock?
I'm thus bold to put your grace in mind of what you promised me.
Well, but what's the clock?
Why, upon the stroke of 10.
Well, let it strike.
Why let it strike?
Because that, like a jack, thou keepest the stroke betwixt thy begging and my meditation. I'm not in the giving vein today.
Why then, resolve me whether you will or thou troublest me.
I'm not in the vein.
Is it even so? Rewards he my true service with such deep contempt? May I have king for this? Oh, let me think on Hastings and be gone to Richmond while my fearful head is on.
The evil and tyrannous deed is done. The most arch and piteous massacre that ever yet this land was guilty of. Dighton and Forrest to mind it suborned to do this ruthless piece of butchery, though they be fleshed villains, bloody dogs, melting with tenderness and kind compassion wept like two children in their death-sad stories. Thus both are gone, with conscience and remorse. They could not speak, and so I am left to bring these tidings to the bloody king.
Kind Tyrell, am I happy in thy news?
If to do the thing you gave in charge be yet your happiness, be happy then, for it is done, my lord.
But didst thou see them dead?
I did. The chaplain of the tower hath buried.
Come to me, Tyrell, soon after supper, and be inheritor of thy desires. Farewell till then. The sons of Edward sleep in Abraham's bosom. And Anne, my wife, hath bid the world good night. Now, I know that Breton Richmond aims at my brother's daughter, and by that knot looks proudly over the crown. To her I go, a jolly, thriving wooer.
My lord!
Good news or bad that thou comest in so bluntly?
Bad news, my lord. Eli has fled to Richmond. And Buckingham, back with the hardy Welshman, is in the field, and still his power increaseth.
Eli with Richmond troubles me more near than Buckingham and his rash levied army. Well, come, master men, my counsel is my shield. We must be brief when traitors break the field.
Carnal cur preys on the issue of his mother's body.
Henry his wife. Triumph not in my woes. God witness with me, I have wept for thine.
Bear with me. I am hungry for revenge, and now I cloy thee with beholding it. Thy Edward, he is dead, that stabbed my Edward. Thy other Edward, that acquit my Edward. Thy Clarence, he is dead, that killed my Edward. And the beholders of this tragic play, the adulterous Hastings, Rivers, Ray, untimely smothered in their dusky graves. Richard yet lives. Hell's black intelligencer canceled his bond of life. Dear God, I pray that I may live to say the dog is dead.
Oh, thou didst prophesy the time would come when I should wish for thee to help me curse that bottled spider, that foul-bunched backtoad.
I call thee then, vain flourish of my fortune. I call thee then, poor shadow, painted queen. The presentation of but what I was, the dream of what thou wert, breath, a bubble, queen in jest only to fill the scene. Where is thy husband now? Where be thy brothers? Where are thy children? Wherein dost thou joy? Who sues to thee and cries, God save the queen? Where be the bending peers that flattered thee? Where be the thronging troops that followed thee? Thus hath the course of justice wheeled about and left thee but a very prey to time. Thou didst usurp my place, and dost thou not usurp the just proportion of my sorrow? Now thy proud neck bears half my burden yoke, from which even here I slip my weary neck and leave the burden of it all on thee. Farewell, York's wife, and queen of sad mischance. These English woes will make me smile in France.
Oh, thou well skilled in curses, stay a while and teach me how to curse mine enemies.
Forbear to sleep the nights and fast the days. Compare dead happiness with living woe. Think that thy babes were fairer than they were, and he that slew them fouler than he is. Bettering thy loss makes the bad cause a worse. Revolving this will teach thee how to curse.
My words are dull. Oh, quicken them with thine.
Thy woes will make them sharp and pierce like mine.
Go with me. And in the breath of bitter words, let's smother my damned son, which thy two sweet sons did smother. I hear his drum be copious and exclaims.
Who intercepts my expedition?
No. She that might have intercepted thee by strangling thee in her accursed womb, from all the slaughters, wretch, that thou hast done.
Tell me, thou villain slave, where are my children?
Thou toad! Where is thy brother Clarence?
A florist's trumpets! Strike alarums, drums! Let not the heavens hear these telltale women! Rail on the Lord's anointed! Strike, I say! Either be patient and entreat me fair, or with the clamorous report of war, thus will I drown your exclamation.
Art thou my son?
I thank God, my father, and yourself.
Then patiently hear my impatience.
Oh, madam, I have a touch of your condition, which cannot brook the accent of your truth.
I will be mild and gentle in my speech.
And brief, good mother, for I am in haste.
Art thou so hasty? I have stayed for thee, God knows, in anguish, pain, and agony.
Oh, came I not at last to comfort you?
No, by the holy rood, thou knowest it well. Thou camest on earth to make the earth my hell. The grievous burden was thy birth to me. Tetchy and wayward was thy infancy. Thy school days, frightful, desperate, wild, and furious. The prime of manhood, daring, bold, adventurous. Thy age confirmed, proud, subdued, bloody, treacherous. What comfortable hour canst thou name that ever graced thee in my company.
If I be so disgraceful in your sight, then let me march on and not offend your grace. Strike the drum!
Prithee, hear me speak.
You speak too bitter.
Hear me a word. I shall never speak to thee again.
So?
Either thou wilt die by God's just ordinance, or from this war thou turn a conqueror. Or I, aged, extreme grief shall perish and never look upon thy face again. Therefore, take with thee my most heavy curse, which in the day of battle tire thee more than all the complete armor that thou wearest. My prayers are the adverse part of fight, and there are the little souls of Edward's children. Whisper the spirits of thine enemies and promise them success and victory. Bloody thou art, bloody will be thy end. Shame serves thy life, and doth thy death attend.
Though far more cause, yet much less spirit to curse abides in me. I say amen to all.
Mistake, madam. I would have a word with you.
I have no more sons of the royal blood for me to know.
You have a daughter called Elizabeth, virtuous and fair, royal and gracious.
And must she die for this, or let her live?
Then know that from my heart I love thy daughter, and mean to make her queen of England.
Say then, who dost thou mean shall be her king?
Well, even he that makes her queen, who should be else?
What, thou?
I, even I. What think you of it, madam?
How canst thou woo her?
Well, that would I learn of you.
And wilt thou learn of me?
Well, madam, with all my heart.
Send to her by the man that slew her brother. Pair of bleeding hearts. They're on a grave, Edward and York. Then happy she will be. If this inducement force her not to love, send her a story of thy noble acts. Tell her thou madest away her uncle Clarence, her uncle Rivers, yea, and for her sake, made it quick conveyance of her good aunt Anne.
Oh, well, come, come, you mock me. This is not the way to win thy daughter.
There is no other way.
Well, say I did all this for love of her.
Nay, that indeed she cannot choose but hate thee, having bought love with such a bloody spoil.
Look, what is done cannot now be amended. Men shall deal unadvisedly sometimes, which after hours gives leisure to repent. If I have killed the issue of your womb, to quicken your increase, I will beget my issue of your blood upon your daughter. Your children are a vexation to your youth, but mine shall be a comfort to your age. The loss you have is but a son being king, and by that loss a daughter is made queen. I cannot make you what amends I would. Therefore, accept such kindness as I can. What, we have many goodly days to see. Go then, my mother. To thy daughter go. Put in her tender heart the aspiring flame of golden sovereignty. Acquaint her with the sweet, silent hours of marriage joys. And when this arm of mine hath chastised the petty rebel, dull-brained Buckingham, bound in triumphant garlands will I come, and lead thy daughter to a conqueror's bed.
What were I best to say? Her father's brother would be her lord, or shall I say her uncle? Or he that slew her brothers and her uncles.
Infer fair England's peace by this alliance.
Which she shall purchase with still lasting war.
Say, I will love her everlastingly.
But how long shall that title ever last?
Sweetly enforce until her fair life's end.
But how long fairly shall her sweet life last?
So long as heaven and nature lengthens it.
So long as hell and Richard likes of it.
Your reasons are too shallow and too quick.
Oh no, my reasons are too deep and dead. Too deep and dead, poor infants in their grave.
Well, then now, by my George, my garter, and my crown.
Profaned, dishonored, and the third you serve.
I swear.
By nothing. Swear by something thou hast not wronged.
Then by the world.
'Tis full of thy foul wrong.
My father's death.
Thy life hath that dishonored.
Then myself.
Thyself thyself misuses.
I thank to God.
God's wrong is most wrong. If thou hast feared to break an oath by him, the imperial medal circling now thy brow had graced the tender temples of my child. And both the princes had been breathing near, that now, two tender playfellows to dust, thy broken faith hath made a prey for worms. What canst thou swear by now?
It's a time to come.
Swear not by time to come.
for that thou hast misused ere used by time misused or past.
As I intend to prosper and repent, so thrive I in my dangerous attempt at hostile arms. Myself confound! Be opposite all planets of good luck to my proceedings. If not with pure heart's love, I tender not thy beauteous princely daughter. In her consists my happiness and thine. Without her falls upon herself and me and thee and many a Christian soul, death, desolation, ruin, and decay. It cannot be avoided but by this. It will not be avoided but by this.
Shall I be tempted of the devil thus?
Aye, if the devil tempt thee to do good.
But thou didst kill my children.
But in your daughter's womb I will bury them. Or in the nest of spicery they shall breed selves of themselves to your recomforture.
Shall I go win my daughter to thy will?
Be a happy mother by the deed.
I go. Write to me very shortly, and you will understand from me her mind.
Bear her my true love's kiss, and so farewell. Relenting fool and shallow, changing woman. How now, what news with you?
My gracious sovereign, on the western coast right of the puissant navy, it's thought to be led by Richmond, and there they all expected but the aid of Buckingham to help them ashore.
Some light-footed friend post to the Duke of Norfolk. Ratcliffe, thyself, or Catesby.
Here, my lord.
Fly to the Duke. Bid him levy the greatest strength and power he can make it, and me be presently at Salisbury.
I go.
How now? What news with you?
None so good, my lord, to please you with the hearing. Nor so bad, but it may well be told.
Well, hoy day, a riddle! Neither good nor bad! Once more, what news?
Richmond is on the seas.
Pull there, let him sink, and be the seas on him. What doth he there?
Not my dishonor, but my guess. He makes for England. He already claimed the crown.
Is the king dead? Is the empire unpossessed? What heir of York is there alive but we? And who is England's king but Great York's heir? Then tell me, what doth he upon the sea?
If not for this, my liege, I cannot guess.
Revolt, and fly to him, I fear.
No, mighty liege, therefore must trust me not.
Wherefore is thy power, then, to beat him back?
My good lord, my friends are in the...
Oh, cold friends to Richard! What do they in the north, when they should serve their sovereign in the west?
They have not been commanded, sovereign. Please, if your majesty give me leave, I will muster my friends, and meet your grace where and at what time your grace shall
be. Oh, no, thou wilt be gone to join with Richmond! I will not trust you, sir!
Most mighty sovereign, I have no cause to hold my friendship doubtful. I never was, nor never will, false.
Well, go muster then. But, hear you. Leave behind your son, George Stanley. Look that your faith be firm, or else his head's assurance is but fray.
So deal with him as I prove true to you.
My gracious sovereign, now in Devonshire, Sir Edward Courtney and the haughty prelate, Bishop of Exeter, his brother there, with many more confederates, are in arms.
My liege, in Kent, the Guildfords are in arms.
At every hour, more competitors flock to their aid, and still their power increases.
My lord, the army of the Duke of Buckingham.
Out on you, owls! Why, nothing but songs of death! Take that, till thou bringest me better news!
The news I have to tell your majesty is that by sudden floods and fall of waters, Buckingham's army is dispersed and scattered.
Lord, I cry you mercy. Here's my purse to cure that blow of thine.
My leap!
The Duke of Buckingham is taken, that is the best news. That the Earl of Richmond is with a mighty power landed at Milford is colder tidings, yet they must be told.
No way towards Salisbury! Reason here while battle might be won and lost.
consented that he shall espouse Elizabeth, her daughter. These letters will resolve it on my mind. Farewell.
Will not King Richard let me speak with him?
No, my good lord. Therefore, be patient.
Hastings, Edward's children, Rivers and Gray, Holy King Henry, and all of this carried even for revenge, bought my destruction.
It is All Souls' Day, please be as it not.
It is, my lord.
And then All Souls' Day is my body's doomsday. This is the day that, in King Edward's time, I wish might fall on me when I prove false to his children or his wife's allies. This is the day I wish to fall by the false faith of him I trusted most. This is All Souls' Day, is my fearful soul is the determined rest of my life. The high old seer that I bound with, that turned my fated crown on my head and grant me an earnest when I bade him jest. Thus does he forge the swords of wicked men who turn their points on their master's business. And this word was first followed upon them. She, quoth he, shall split thy heart with sorrow. Remember, the heart is in Providence. Come, sir. Pray me to the block of shame. Wrong hath but wrong. And blame the due of blame.
Fellows in arms, and my most loving friends, bruised underneath the yoke of tyranny, thus far into the bowels of the land have we marched on without impediment. And here, receive we from our father Stanley lines of fair comfort and encouragement. The wretched, bloody, and usurping boar that spoils your summer fields and fruitful vines, swills your warm blood like wash, and makes his trough in your embowelled bosoms. This foul swine lies now even in the center of this isle, near to the town of Leicester, as we learn. From Tamworth thither is but one day's march. In God's name, cheer thee on, courageous friends, to reap the harvest of perpetual peace by this one bloody trial of sharp war.
Every man's conscience is a thousand swords to fight against that bloody homicide.
I doubt not, but his friends will fly to us.
He hath no friends, but who are friends for fear, which in his greatest need will strengthen him.
We offer our vantage. Then in God's name, march! True hope is swift, and flies on swallows' wings. Kings, it makes gods. Meaner creatures, kings.
Here pitch our tents. Here will I lie tonight. And where tomorrow? Not all's one for that. Who hath described the number of the foe?
6,000 or 7,000 is their utmost power.
Why? Our battalion trebles that account. Besides, King's name is a tower of strength, which they upon the adverse party want. Let us survey the vantage of the field. To want no discipline, make no delay. For lords, tomorrow is a busy day.
The weary sun hath made a golden set. By the red track of his fiery car, his signal a goodly day tomorrow. Where is Lord Stanley quartered, dost thou know?
His regiment lies half a mile at least south of the mighty power of the king.
If without peril it be possible, good Dorset, bear my good night to him. And give him from me this most needful scroll.
Well, my wife ought to take it, my lord, so that I keep you quiet resting.
Good night, Dorset.
What's the clock?
Supper time, my lord, it's 9 o'clock.
I will not sup tonight. Catesby.
My lord.
Call us Lord Stan. Bid him bring his power before sunrising, lest his son George fall into the blind cave of eternal night. Ratcliffe. I have not the alacrity of spirit nor cheer I was wont to have. Bid my guard watch and leave me. Ratcliffe! By the mean of night, come to my tent and help to arm me. Believe me, I say!
Fortune and victory set on thy helm. All comfort that the dark night can afford be to thy person, noble stepfather. Tell me, how fares our loving mother?
Aye, my attorney, bless thee from thy mother, who prays continually for Richmond's good. Had I battled early in the morning, thy fortune and the victory of the bloody strokes and the warmest hand of the world. As I may, best event will deceive the time, by the side of the navigator forward, was being seen by Rhode and George, the executed at his father's side. Adieu. Be valiant and speed well.
I'll strive with troubled thoughts to take a nap, lest leaden slumber pease me down tomorrow when I should mount the wings of victory. Chastisement, that we may praise thee in the victory. To thee I do commend my watchful soul, sleeping and waking only. Defend me still.
When I was mortal, my anointed bride by thee was punched full of deadly holes. Think on the tower and weep, despair and die. Henry the Sixth bids thee despair and die. Virtuous and holy, be thou conqueror. Henry, that prophesied thou shouldst be king, doth comfort thee in thy sleep. Live and flourish.
Let me sit heavy on thy summer tomorrow. I that was washed to death with fulsome wine. Poor Clarence, by thy guile, betrayed to death. Tomorrow in the battle, think of me, and fall thy edgeless sword. Despair and die. Thou offspring of the House of Lancaster, the wronged heirs of York do pray for thee. Good angels, guard thy battle. Live and flourish.
Bloody and guilty, guiltily awake, and in a bloody battle end thy days. Think on Lord Hastings. Despair, despair I, and die. Quiet, untroubled soul, awake, arm, fight, and conquer for fair England's sake.
Dream on thy cousin smothered in the tower. Let us be led within thy bosom, Richard, and weigh thee down to ruin, shame, and death. Thy nephew's souls bid thee despair and die.
Sleep, Richard. Sleep in peace and wake in joy. Good angels guard thee from the boar's annoy. Live and beget the happy race of kings. Edward's unhappy sons do bid thee flourish.
Richard, thy wife, that wretched Anne, thy wife, never slept a bright hour with thee, now fills thy sleep with perturbations. Tomorrow in the battle, think on me, and fall that edgeless sword.
Despair and die.
Thou fight soul, sleep thou fight sleep, dream of success and happy victory. Thy adversary's wife doth pray for thee.
The last was us to help thee to the crowd. The last was I to feel thy tyranny. Oh, in the battle, think on Buckingham, and die in terror of thy guiltiness. Dream on of bloody deeds and death, fating, despair, despairing yield thy breath, despair, despair. I died in hope ere I could lend thee aid, but cheer thy heart, be not dismayed. God and good angel fight on Richmond's side, and Richard falls in the height of all his pride.
Give me another horse. Bind up my wounds. Have mercy, Jacob! I did betray him. Oh, coward conscience, how dost thou afflict me? Cold, fearful drops stand on my trembling flesh. Oh, what do I fear? Myself? None else, though. No, no. Richard loves Richard. As is I, am I. Is there a murderer here? No. Yes. I am. No, but I did. Alar, or not. Oh, fool, thyself speak well, fool. Do not flatter. Oh, my conscience hath a thousand tongues, and every tongue condemns me for a villain, and every wicked assembled tale, and perjury of the highest degree, murder. Stem murder of the direst degree. Oh, all several sins all used in each degree, clogged to the bar, cried all, guilty, guilty! Oh. Lord, shall despair. There is no creature loves me. If I die, no soul shall pity me. Oh, why, wherefore should they? Since that I in myself can find in myself no pity to myself.
My lord!
Ah, soon to his air!
Radcliffe, my lord, tis I.
Oh, Radcliffe.
Friends up and buckle on their armor.
Oh, Radcliffe, I have dreamed a fearful dream. Oh, thinkest thou? Will our friends prove all true?
No doubt, my lord.
Oh, Radcliffe. Oh, I fear.
Nay, hey, good, my lord. Be not afraid of shadows.
Oh, God, by the Apostle Paul, shadows tonight have struck more fear into the heart of Richmond than Richard, and it can the souls of 10,000 soldiers. It is not yet near day. Come. Unto my tents I will play the eavesdropper to see if any need to shrink from me.
Tomorrow, Richmond.
Cry mercy, watchful gentlemen, that contain a tardy sluggard here.
Come, said my lord.
The sweetest sleep, the fairest boding dreams that ever entered in a drowsy head, have I since our departure had, my lord. Methought their souls, whose bodies Richard murdered, came to my tent and cried on victory. I promise you, my soul is very jocund in the remembrance of so fair a dream. How far into the morning is it?
On stroke four.
Why then, 'tis time to arm and give direction. More than I have said, loving countrymen, the leisure and enforcement of the time forbids to dwell upon. Yet, remember this. God and our good cause fight upon our side. Richard, accept those whom we fight against and rather have us win than him they follow. For what is he they follow? Truly, gentlemen, a bloody tyrant and a homicide. One raised in blood, and one in blood established. One that made means to come by what he hath, and slaughtered those that were the means to help him. The base, foul stone, made precious by the foil of England's chair, where he is falsely set. One that hath ever been God's enemy. Then if you fight against God's enemy, God will, in justice, ward you as his soldiers. Men, in the name of God and all these rites, advance your standards. Draw your willing swords. Sound drums and trumpets bold and cheerfully. God and St. George, Richmond and victory.
Who saw the sun today?
Not I, my lord.
That he disdains to shine. For by the book he should have braved the east an hour ago. Black day will it be for somebody. Radcliffe.
My lord.
The sun will not be seen today. The sky doth frown and lower upon our army. And would these dewy tears were from the ground. Not shine today. But what is that to me more than to Richmond? For that self-same heaven that frowns on me looks sadly upon him.
Arm, my lord, the foe wants in the field.
Oh, come, bustle, to Paris in my horse. Call up Lord Stanley, bid him bring his power. I will lead forth my soldiers to the plain. Come, gentlemen, let not our babbling dreams affright our souls. Conscience is but a word that cowards use, devised at first to keep the strong in awe. Our strong arms be our conscience, and swords our law.
Come, gentlemen, every man unto his charge. Remember whom you are to cope with all. A sort of vagabonds, rascals, and runaways. A scum of Bretons and base lackey peasants. And who doth lead them but a paltry fellow? A milk sop. One that never in his life felt so much cold as overshoes in snow. If we be conquered, let men conquer us, and not these bastard Bretons whom our fathers have in their own lands beaten, bogged, and thumped. Shall these enjoy our lands, lie with our wives, ravish our daughters? Fight, gentlemen of England! Fight, brave yeomen! Draw archers, draw your arrows to the head! Amaze the welkin with your broken staves! What says Lord Stanley? Will he bring his power?
My lord, he doth deny to come.
Off with his son George's head!
My lord, the enemy is past the marsh. After the battle, let George Stanley die.
1,000 hearts are great within my bosom. Advance your standards! Call upon your foes with the ancient word of courage! Fair St. George, inspire us with the spleen of fiery dragons. Upon them, victory sits on our helms.
Rescue! Rescue! The king enacts more wonders than a man. His horse is slain, and all on foot he fights, seeking for Richmond in the throat of death. Rescue, fair lords, or else the day is lost.
A horse! A horse!
Withdraw, my lord, I'll help you to a horse!
I have set my life upon the cast, and will stand the hazard of the die. I think there be 6 Richmonds in the field. 5 have I slain today instead of him. A horse! A horse! My kingdom for a horse!
Victorious friends, the day is ours! The bloody dog is dead!
Courageous Richmond, well hast thou equipped thee!
Lo! Behold! This long usurped royalty from the dead temples of the bloody wretch have I plucked off! Grace thy brow, my lord. Wear it, enjoy it, and make much of it. Great God in heaven, say amen to all. But tell me, is young George Stanley living?
He is, my lord.
Proclaim a pardon to the soldiers fled, that in submission will return to us. And then, as we have united this, as we attain the sacrament, we will unite the white robes and the red. Smile, heaven, upon this fair conjunction. England hath long been mad and scarred herself. The brother blindly shed the brother's blood. The father rashly slaughtered his own son. The son compelled and butchered to the sire. All this divided York and Lancaster. Oh, now, let Richmond and Elizabeth, the true succeeders of each royal house, by God's fair ordinance, conjoin together. And let their heirs, God, if thy will be so, enrich the time to come with smooth-faced peace, with smiling plenty, and fair and prosperous days. Now civil wounds are stopped. Peace lives again. That she may long live here, God say, amen.